Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In a recent Space News episode, we begin the first of a series of reports that challenged the very underpinnings of consensus scientific theory on the nature of stars, including our own sun. Ever finer technological data continues to provide increasing opportunities to test the respective predictions of the electric universe theories versus those of institutional science. As Wal Thornhill explains in the first of this two-part episode, new discoveries all point toward the perhaps inevitable confirmation of the electric star theory.
Scientists don't understand stars. Not a single feature of the sun is predictable based on the standard model of the sun. We can't see inside the sun except for a peep through the holes punched in the photosphere we call sunspots. And there we don't see energy trying to escape from inside the sun. It's cooler down there. That's why the sunspots appear dark. But as usual, a model, once adopted as a standard, becomes a belief. Stars are believed to be isolated thermonuclear campfires in the sky that eventually burn out. All data must be fitted somehow to the model or discarded as an error. The operative word is somehow. No alternative model is possible. That is how we fallible mortals apply the scientific method. Many who are familiar with the electric universe have said to me they can't watch astronomy programs because the blatant misinformation makes them angry. The programs begin with a litany of facts, most of which are baseless. For example, a popular online lecture in physics enthuses, and I quote, "A star is born when nuclear fusion ignites and produces heat. The star is formed first when matter falls in gravitationally. Matter attracts each other and falls in and heats up to tens of millions of degrees. Then nuclear fusion produces energy and the star is born. Our sun was born about 5 billion years ago." End of quote. So goes the myth. There is not a single fact in any of this. It ignores the recent evidence of stars being born in molecular clouds along glowing current filaments. It doesn't match the story. The discovery shows dust and gas is efficiently scavenged over many light years towards the current filament, unlike weak gravitational collapse, which is limited in range and directed radially inwards towards a center of mass. Any rotation of the cloud inhibits gravitational collapse, giving time for the heat generated by matter spiraling inwards to be radiated away. Nuclear fusion in stellar cores composed somehow of the lightest element, hydrogen, is the improbable claimed result. The fusion model of stellar energy was grasped at more than a century ago, simply because it seemed like the only option for an isolated star producing prodigious energy for unimaginable time spans. Yet as our project manager and chief engineer of the Sapphire experiment, which is designed to test an electrical model of stars, pointed out, the steady shining of countless stars in the night sky requires they be lit by a simple controlled process. The hydrogen bomb model applied to stars is not simple, stable, or testable. If it were the answer, our night sky should resemble a fireworks show. Meanwhile, our experimental attempts to force nature to conform to our beliefs have led nowhere in the quest for fusion power like the sun. Clearly, scientists don't understand stars, their birth, how they shine, and their supposed death. Recent reports highlight this obvious fact. Phys.org reported on September 12 last year, and I quote, "Stars form within the dense regions of diffuse molecular clouds, but the physical processes that determine the locations, rate, and efficiency of star formation are poorly understood. Recent thinking envisions an approximate two-step process. First, a network of dense filaments form due to large-scale turbulence, and then fragmentation into cores occurs as gravity starts to dominate. In the dense gas, the structure formation is affected by motions induced primarily by three processes: supersonic turbulence, self-gravity, and magnetic fields." End of quote. The words "poorly understood" are code for "we have no idea." There is no known way that supersonic turbulence and magical magnetic fields can produce the many light years long, constant width, glowing filaments and their structured magnetic fields. Astrophysicists are ignorant of Hans Alfvén's prediction made decades ago that stars would be formed precisely that way, by powerful scavenging of matter along magnetically pinched galactic current filaments inside molecular clouds. The reason given by one astrophysicist: we know there's electricity in space, but it doesn't do anything. Such is the dysfunction of narrow specialism in science. So a star is not formed when matter falls in gravitationally, and matter doesn't fall in and heat up to tens of millions of degrees. The electrical accretion process stratifies elements radially according to their ionization potential. It produces cool cores of heavy elements like beads on a string. But nuclear fusion in a cool, heavy element core is impossible. So it makes far more sense that stars are a cosmic electrical phenomenon involving their photospheres. Fusion occurs on the Sun, not in it. All stars produce the heavy elements seen in their spectra by warm plasma fusion and neutron capture in their photospheres, in contrast to the brute force approach of particle physicists requiring incredible pressure and millions of degrees. Earlier in May last year, there appeared a groundbreaking paper in the journal Astronomy and Astrophysics, which showed a slingshot effect in a star-birthing filament of the Orion Nebula. These glowing filaments snake about inside the nebula like the radiant filaments in novelty plasma balls. The stars are formed while moving with the filament, but as the star gets more massive, it is slung out, ready formed and switched on as the glowing filament accelerates away. This may help explain the size limit of stars. Stars are the electromagnetic offspring of electric galaxies. So nearby stars have rotation axes that line up closely with each other because they are all spun up along the same rotating electrical umbilical cord, known as a Birkeland current. Do we have evidence for the alignment of spinning stars born in the same event? Yes, we do. And as usual, it has mystified researchers. On March 14th this year, John Ross in the Australian National Newspaper reported, "Australian astronomers studying stars' internal upheavals have opened a new fault line in theories about the universe's formation. Researchers monitoring star quakes, the stellar equivalent of earthquakes, have found a startling symmetry in dozens of swollen stars known as red giants. The findings open a new mystery around the formation of clusters of stars from swirling clouds of molecules and gas." Co-author Dennis Stello said these gas clouds rotated on their own internal axes. Astronomers had assumed the initial spin orientation would become scrambled by the colossal turbulence generated when they coalesced into families of stars. "The results were unexpected," said Dr. Stello. "We found that the spins of most of the stars were aligned with each other. Previously, it had been assumed that massive turbulence would have scrambled the rotational energy of the clouds where the stars were born and prevented this alignment." This statement shows characteristic blindness toward earlier evidence that also doesn't fit the accepted story of starbirth. So the published paper doesn't refer to the filamentary starbirth paper, where the answer to the mystery clearly lies. Specialists tend to ignore other specialists, even in their own field, when findings are off the edges of their belief map. Such is the dysfunctional state of modern science.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.